I'm Jonathan Tepperman. I'm the managing editor of Foreign Affairs magazine here in New York. I'm going to introduce the next session the following way. As you all know, this forum is being held during a particularly tumultuous time in world history. In fact, there's this prevailing conventional wisdom that we're living through a time of terrible and potentially even terminal decline. Now, I'm not sure I agree with this narrative, but it's easy to see why many people do. The global economy is grinding to a halt. The Middle East is in flames, spawning waves of terrorism and refugees in all directions. China and Russia have grown more belligerent in recent years. And then here in the West, as we've been hearing all day, our political systems seem to be self-destructing. Our next group of speakers are going to take all of this on and break it down for us, and I hope help pierce this very pessimistic narrative. So let me get to them right away. Our first speaker is Ian Bremmer. Ian's the president and founder of Eurasia Group, a global political risk consulting firm. He's also published numerous books, including his latest, which is called Superpower, Three Choices for America's Role in the World. You also should know that Ian is a man who almost never wears a tie, so the fact that he's made this concession today is something that we should all take as a sign of the respect with which he, and the seriousness with which he takes this forum. Please welcome Ian Bremmer.
General Petraeus will tell you that it's not my tie but I'm making good. And the second introduction for John Tepperman, who used to be a colleague of mine at Eurasia Group, and he's awesome and fantastic, doing a wonderful job at Foreign Affairs, and very capable hands the next hour. I've got 15 minutes to talk to you about the world, and that's hard to do. But maybe I'll start with a few things that will help pierce the veil of negativity. Here's one. I don't know what you think about it, but I opened up the Business Council in Naples, Florida about 6 weeks ago, and the first question I got, 93 American CEOs in attendance, all Fortune 500, the first question I got was, so what do you think about what would happen if Trump became president and Trump turned around? I said, well, let me ask you, how many of you would change your investments for your companies, your views on the United States, if Trump were to win? Just give me a show of hands. I got zero. If I had asked them about Turkey, if Erdogan was gone, if I'd asked them about Russia, if Putin was gone, if I'd asked them about China, if Xi Jinping was gone, if I'd asked them about Brazil, now that Dilma Rousseff is gone and isn't coming back, I would have gotten hands. And in many cases, I would have gotten a lot. So let's remember that as much as I know it's an 18-month election, it's billions of dollars, it's a subversion of democracy, we're the most important country in the world, we're the most intelligent, we allow ourselves to have our hair get on fire over this stuff, right? And our allies are freaked out too, I know. But let's recognize that, you know, Obama was a massive transition for Bush, and his ability to make dramatic changes in policy for the United States have been very constrained, and rightfully so. This is a consolidated, advanced industrial democracy that does actually mean something when we talk about the world here. I certainly agree that there are pieces of the world that are in flames, and there are a few things that I'm worried about in particular. I'm worried about authoritarian leaders that look brittle. I'm worried about the Saudis. I'm worried about the Turks. In fact, I'm increasingly worried about a lot of emerging markets because there are a few big trends that I'll just throw at you. Right? One that I've written about a lot, I call it G0, is that if the United States doesn't want to play the same leadership role it has historically, and it's not because we're not interventionist, we still intervene. Ask Snowden. Right? We still intervene. Look at drones. We still intervene. Ask Sepp Blatter and FIFA. Right? We still intervene. Ask Bank Paribas. We use our tools, but we're more unilateralist in the way we intervene. Our allies are more unnerved by that. But if we're not going to be the global policeman, or if we're not going to be the same global architect on trade, and at best, TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, is a 50-50 deal at this point, given what happens in the lame duck session after the Obama, after the 2016 election. And if we're not going to be the cheerleaders of global values, well, who else is going to? No one in particular. That's one big reason. A second big reason is that for the last 75 years, globalization has largely been about emerging market jobs trumping developed market jobs, and a global middle class rising as a consequence. Right? And we've seen that. We've seen the top 1% do very well, and we've seen the global middle class emerging. We've seen the hollowing out in the developed countries of what we call middle classes, but in reality, very wealthy segments of global society. So when Piketty writes about capital and says, oh my God, inequality, but in reality, he's talking about Europe and the United States, you know, we should recognize that. But what we are clearly seeing, and I don't know who saw the press announcement from Adidas yesterday, right? Adidas is now closing a couple of big production facilities in Asia, and they're opening a big one in Germany. There's going to be 160 jobs created with this new factory because it's all automated, because it's robots. And we see Wendy's just last week said that all 80,000 franchises, the front of the store is now going to be automated. And this is happening in every sector, and it's happening all over the world. Well, if that continues, then the next phase of globalization is technology, and by the way, largely developed market technology, and by the way, most importantly, American technology, actually trumps emerging market labor. And that makes a lot of emerging market leaders very politically vulnerable. And there's another thing that makes them vulnerable. Think about WikiLeaks. Think about Sony Pictures. Think about Ashley Madison. Then again, don't really think about Ashley Madison. Not too much. Think about Panama Papers, right? What we see is the expansion and expansion of forced transparency by relatively small numbers of individuals that happen to be critically connected in nodes where they have access to information, and they're agitated, and they can't change the system, but they can force the transparency. I wasn't particularly worried when WikiLeaks hit, because at the end of the day, if you take all of the State Department's documents and you make them public, what do you find out? Well, number one, you find out the State Department's pretty competent. Okay. Number two, you find out that Hillary Clinton thought that Christina Kirchner was emotionally unhinged. We kind of knew that. Number three, we found out that Hamid Karzai in Afghanistan was corrupt. Shocking headline, right? We didn't learn that much. What happens when WikiLeaks hits Saudi Arabia? What happens when it hits Russia? I'm less worried about it hitting China, believe it or not, because China's so much more stovepipes. I don't think you have individuals that have access to that breadth of information. But these phenomena that the United States will provide less global leadership, less global security, that emerging market labor is increasingly going to be under pressure, and therefore the legitimization of a lot of these governments and leaders, and that also you're going to see much more forced transparency, makes you think that emerging markets, which used to be the great play, are actually going to be under a lot of stress. And any of you that read Jeff Immelt's commencement speech at NYU last week, and if you didn't, take a look, where he talks about the end of globalization, what he basically says, you know what, GE's not going to export so much anymore. Our supply chains are going to get shorter. We're going to bet a lot more on the US. We see protectionism rising. The Lexus, the nexus of protectionism right now is really about Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. It's really about, you know, all of the polarization that you see across Europe. If these trends continue, that's going to shift dramatically towards the emerging markets. And yes, you will see more fragmentation in the global marketplace, but is that bad news for the world economy? No, it's a much more dramatic change between who the winners and who the losers are. And you see it most clearly in the Middle East today. Middle East was not stable, but you could at least say that the Middle East had a period of frozen instability for the last 40 years. For a few basic reasons. One is that the Americans provide a lot of security along with allies. Two is they could take a lot of money out of the ground. And three is that their populations were relatively quiescent, despite the fact that they were poorly governed. Well, each of the three factors I just mentioned have been undermined, right? One, the US doesn't feel like doing as much. Number two, you have a technology that has suddenly meant that the most productive energy country in the world is the United States. OPEC has been destroyed. And that was even before the Iran deal. Now that you've done the Iran deal, we've been producing vastly more oil over the course of the coming months, even more so. And finally, these populations are increasingly not quiescent. Why? Because they have access to information. So I mean,
I appreciate that Mohammed bin Salman, the 31-year-old deputy crown prince of Saudi Arabia, gets the joke. I appreciate that someone finally is saying, we've got to change really fast. But here's the thing, they really need to do that 20 years ago. 2 years ago, I was in Saudi Arabia. I remember one of the princes telling me that they were diversified, the economy was diversified, look at petrochemicals. That's like saying, look at light and heavy crude. That's not really diversification, right? I mean, they told me that fracking was a CIA conspiracy, just trying to cow the Saudis into doing what we want. You know, if you have a son or a daughter that got out of college or is staying with you at your house, and you say, come on, it's time to get out and work, that you might have some success with that. If that son or daughter is 45, it's harder. Right? So I wouldn't bet on the Saudis getting this right. I think, and aside from the fact that the Deputy Crown Prince actually isn't in control of everything and might not get it to be, I think it's too late. And do I think, therefore, that a more moderated bet on the Middle East is to be called for? I actually do. Do I think that Mr. Erdogan is going to be able to actually control? He's gotten rid of his prime minister, Mr. Davutoglu, who was competent and a loyalist, but was not willing to go to the mat for changing the constitution to make Turkey into a sultanate. Wasn't willing to do it. And so what happened as a consequence? Well, he basically put in a functionary. His son-in-law is the deputy, is the energy minister at this point. This isn't good, because as much as Erdogan might want to be the sultan, he can't get it done. And it's not the authoritarian leaders we have to watch out for. It's the authoritarian leaders who feel insecure and vulnerable. Xi Jinping is actually quite strong today. On balance, I'd argue, that's a good thing. Because if Xi Jinping was feeling really weak, geopolitics in Asia would look a lot worse. The Indians and the Chinese are now talking about establishing a red line for direct defense communications, and actually the trade relations have been significantly better of late. If you look about India's orientation towards the China-led RCEP as opposed to the US-led TPP that they can't be a part of, that's interesting. I think that even the South China Sea military buildup has been trumped largely by the economic realities of most of the governments in that region who don't want to screw up relations with their most important trade partner. The one thing that we see from Xi Jinping so far, at least, is that he's not been waving the flag and doing militarist stuff to shore himself up at home. And if he starts to, then we've got a problem. Now, look, the biggest questions out there are what happens as China rises and what happens as technology really disrupts geopolitics. And those things do, of course, come together. And I don't pretend to have an answer for that. But what I will tell you is that at least as we see so far, 4 years into Xi Jinping's rule, the anti-corruption campaign has expanded every year. The numbers and also who it's hit. Started with the provinces, then the state-owned enterprises, now it's the central ministries. His willingness to facilitate head of state meetings between the Japanese and the South Koreans, something he'd never do. And the new Taiwanese president, who just got inaugurated, who actually said in her inauguration speech that she was not prepared. Her speech did not reiterate the one-China policy, which has been a red line for a long time, and the Chinese official response is, well, let's not just hear what they say, let's see what they do. That's really good news, given what the alternative could have been. So for now, at least, we have some stability. For now, at least, we have some leaders with political capital in China, in India, in Japan. And Obama's trip to Japan certainly facilitated, by the way, that, though if they can't get TPP done, we have a big problem. Different story. Look, I go on for a long time. But the point is that, yes, the geopolitics are becoming much more unstable, but in a certain part of the world. And it's the very fact that that is not metastasizing globally that means that you're going to get less leadership to respond to it. We have the most powerful terrorist organization in the history of the planet. We have the worst refugee crisis since World War II. We have failed states in Iraq, and Syria, and Libya, Mali, Afghanistan, Yemen. I'm sure there will be more. And yet the United States, China, Japan, the world's three largest economies, do not believe that they really directly affect any of them very strongly. and they're correct in doing so. Obama called ISIS the JV team. Remember, the remainder of that sentence was in terms of their ability to attack the American homeland. Now, you can have a very real conversation, I'm sure you will, about whether the Americans should be doing more about things that don't directly affect the American homeland. Maybe the Americans should take more refugees. We do have a Statue of Liberty, for example, that we appear to have forgotten about. But maybe we should, maybe we shouldn't. But the point is we needn't, because the crisis is not being forced on us the way it's being forced on the Jordanians, who Lord knows deserve support, by far the best government in the region, affecting the Lebanese, affecting the Turks, affecting the Greeks, affecting Angela Merkel, and even affecting the Brits, who in a very few weeks' time will decide, on the basis of a lot of populism, whether or not they're even going to stay in the EU. Let's see where it goes. Let's also recognize it's not the world in flames. And it's precisely because it's not the world in flames that we're going to allow things to get more out of hand than they otherwise might. So that's 15 minutes for me. That's Tour of the World. I am delighted to be with you guys, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of the day. Thanks for coming.